Hello students, today we will discuss about a virtual memory. So it is always difficult to dedicate the entire memory address space for each of the processes that are activate or currently active within the system. So we cannot provide the entire primary memory address for a single process at a time. Normally many processes need to have access to the primary memory, so this memory is actually shared among different processes. We cannot provide the entire memory for a single process, so there must be a mean of sharing a smaller amount of physical memory among many processes. So we should have the sharing of this memory addresses by several processes. So the virtual memory actually divides the physical memory, the physical main memory, into different blocks and allocates them to different processes. So virtual memory is a concept that is used for dividing the primary memory into different blocks and share these blocks into different processes like P1 or P2. So P1 will be utilizing some this block, like P2 will be utilizing this particular block. So this is the primary or main memory, primary memory or main memory. So virtual memory is the concept of dividing the memory and distributing the memory blocks into, or allocate the memory block into, different processes. Now if a program is too large for physical memory, if a program is too large for a physical memory, now assume that we are playing a game and the game requires this entire, if the primary memory capacity is very small and it cannot hold the entire memory, means that program cannot be placed within this physical memory, it is the programmer's job to make it fit. So it is possible to fit within this primary memory, otherwise we cannot work on that particular program. Because the size of our program is larger, this is the size of our program, but this is the primary memory. So this is difficult for storing the entire program into the primary memory. So normally what we are doing is the program will be divided into different number of pieces, then different pieces are loaded into, in the form of overlays, different the program will be divided into different portions, and these small pieces are called as overlays, and these overlays are placed in different primary memory locations. Okay, so this is divided into different blocks. So this is what is happening, and some overlays are placed outside, that is part of the secondary memory. Some overlays are there, and currently some overlays are there within the primary memory, and if some overlay is missing, something is there within the primary memory will be moved to a secondary memory, and then from that the required overlay will be moved back to the primary memory. So it is to be ensured that the proper overlay was loaded at the proper time. So according to the requirement, the normal required overlay must be moved from the secondary memory into the primary memory. So the virtual memory was invented to relieve programmers of this burden. So this was the problem with human being, that means they need to bring some programs into the primary memory as and when it is required. So in order to do that automatically, we had the virtual memory concept. So this is the structure of a virtual memory. Virtual memory automatically manages the two levels of memory hierarchy, that is represented by main memory and secondary storage. So the processor will generate a virtual address, and with the support of virtual address it will find out the corresponding memory that is present inside the physical address. And if it is not present in the physical address in physical memory, it will have a reference to the secondary. From secondary, it will move the data from secondary to the primary memory, through which it can be accessed. So processor will be generating a virtual address, and virtual address is having reference to its primary memory, or if the data is within the secondary, it will be having its reference, and later it will be added to the primary memory through which it can be accessed. So in this example, the data A is present in this location of primary memory, B is present in this location, then C is present in this location, but currently D is not available within primary memory, it is there in the secondary storage. So in order to access D, the D to be moved any of the location present in the primary memory through which it can be accessed by the processor. So every time the processor is initiating a program, it will generate a virtual address, and that is to be converted into physical address, that is finding the correct location where the actual data resides in the primary memory. If it is not there, then collect the data from the secondary memory. Sometimes we need to move the available data from the primary memory to the secondary, because there won't be much or enough memory for storing the data that is currently there in the secondary storage. So in addition to share protected memory space and automatically managing the memory hierarchy, virtual memory also simplifies loading the program for execution. So protected memory access means some of the memory location is reserved for operating system, so that cannot be accessible by the user, so that memory to be managed, and loading the program for execution also being simplified by the support of virtual memory. This mechanism is usually called as relocation. That means moving the data from one location to another location, from primary memory to secondary, and from secondary memory to the primary memory, that process is called as relocation. It allows the same program to run in any location in the physical memory. So initially, if the data was there in one memory location, and later if the memory is not available, when it comes again later, so initially now this A was present in this particular memory, but later A was moved to a secondary memory, A was moved to this memory, but then after some time A is returning back to the primary memory. It is not required that the data must be placed in the previous location, sometimes it will be placed in this location. That will not affect the execution of that particular program. So this is another property of utilizing the virtual memory concept. So the same program can run in any of the location in the physical memory. With virtual memory, the processor produces virtual addresses. So the processor will be producing virtual addresses, and it will be translated by the support of some hardware and some software to form physical address. Then through that it will be accessing the main memory. So virtual address to be translated to the physical address, and through which it will be accessing the main memory. And this process is actually called as memory mapping or address translation, converting virtual address into physical address. Now we have a comparison between cache and virtual memories. Now page or segment, they are used instead of block in cache in the case of virtual memory. So in virtual memory we are using either page or segment, that is the division of memory is either called as a page or segment, but it was there in cache it was called as block. Now similarly, page fault or address fault is the name given for a cache miss in the case of cache memory. So there it was cache miss, but here it is page fault or address fault. Now replacement in cache misses is primarily controlled by hardware. So cache, if there is a cache miss, it will be controlled by hardware in the case of cache memory, but in the case of virtual memory it is handled by the operating system by using a replacement strategy. And the size of processor address determines the size of virtual memory. So the processor address, virtual address will determine the size of virtual memory. Based on that will be having the virtual memory size will be decided, but the cache size is independent of the processor address space. There is no relation between the processor address and the cache memory. The file system of virtual memory occupies most of the secondaries. So the supporting file system for the virtual memory is residing at the secondary memory. So it is to be stored permanently in the secondary storage. Now, virtual memory systems can be categorized into two classes. One is a fixed size block and second one is variable size block. Fixed size blocks are also called as pages and variable size blocks are also called as segments. So virtual memory comes under two categories. One is paging and second one is segmentation. So pages are of fixed size, ranges from 4096 to 8192 bytes, but segments are of different sizes. Now the largest segment supported by any processor ranges from 2 raised to 16 bytes up to 2 raised to 32 bytes, and the smallest is 1 byte. So this is an example where in page the code part is divided into equal size, data part is also divided into equal size. In segmentation, code part is divided into different size blocks and data part is also divided into different sized segments. So paging and segmentation are two mechanisms used for dividing the primary memory into different blocks. Now we'll have some more comparison between the page memory and segmentation, paging and segmentation virtual memory concept. Words per address. So in the case of paging, 1 word per address is being stored, but in the case of segment we require 2 words per address. One is for segment and second one is for offset. So from the memory we need to find out the particular segment, and from the segment we need to find out the offset where the exact data reside in that particular segment. That is called as offset. So we require 2 words, that is the segment and offset. Now programmer visible. Now page is invisible to the programmer, but it may be segment may be visible to the programmer. Replacing a block, it is trivial in the case of page, means all blocks are of same size, so there won't be much issue, but it is very hard to implement that in segmentation because the segments are of different sizes, but we require sometimes with a size that is not available. Sometimes we require more data to be stored within the segment because and the memory is not available. So it is hard to implement a replacement of block because that much memory won't be available always for each of the segments. So it is difficult to provide a replacement. Replacement is there, but it is difficult to implement in the case of segmentation. Now memory use inefficiency. In the case of paging, there will be a chance of internal fragmentation because there will be some unused portion of page. Some portion of even that small sized page will be wasted because of some of the size issue of the data that is being stored in the page. Now external fragmentation is a problem related to the segmentation. There also due to the placement of data, there will be some unused pieces of main memory from the segment that is available that cannot be accommodated by any other data. So there will be some fragmentation and some wastage of memory due to fragmentation on both page as well as segmentation. Now the disk traffic, whether it is efficient or not. In the case of page, it is efficient because we can adjust the page size to balance the access time and transfer time. We can have an adjustment in the page size because all the pages are of same size. But it is not always in the case of segmentation because for small segments it requires only few bytes, but for larger it requires more bytes to transfer. So disk traffic will be one, but in the case of page, it is, as it is of small size, it is not a difficult task to move the pages. The decision to use paged virtual memory versus segmented virtual memory affects the processor. So either we can choose any of these two, paged or segmented virtual memory. Page addressing has a single feature size address divided into page number and offset within the page. So in the case of paging, we are not having a separate offset page number. Along with that, the offset is appended. It is a part of the same address itself. A single address does not work for segment address. So in the case of segmentation, one word is used for the address and second one is used for the offset within a particular segment. So it requires two words for storing the address. Now for a memory hierarchy questions, as we were discussing in the cache memory, here also we are having four memory hierarchy questions. First one is where the block can be placed, each block can be placed. Now second one is how it is being found, block identification from the primary memory. Third one is which block will be replaced if there is a miss or a fault. And finally, what happens when we write something into the primary memory. Similar to the cache, we are having four memory hierarchy questions in the case of virtual memory also. So we will see one by one. So where can a block be placed in main memory? So the answer is the OS allows. So OS does the placement of memory block into memory. It allows blocks to be placed anywhere. So this is the answer, anywhere the data or the page can be placed. So this strategy is usually called as fully associative. So within the memory, anywhere we can place the content, that is called as fully associative. Now how is a block found or identified if it is in memory? So we can use paging and segmentation with the support of a data structure that is indexed by a page or segment number. So if we are using paging, we need to use a page table, and if we are using a segmentation, we need to use a segment table. So that is the data structure used for indexing the memory. That means to find out a particular block from the memory. So the data structure contains the physical address of the block, and in the case of segmentation, the offset is added with the physical address to obtain the final physical address. For paging, offset is simply concatenated with the physical address, and in the case of paging, this structure is called as page table, and in the case of segmentation, it is called as segment table. So this is the example for a page. So this is the virtual address, so this is the virtual page number. Then there will be a page table where each pages are being stored. All the referred pages are available within this page table. So it will, according to the virtual page number, virtual address, it will find out a particular page table entry. Then that will be considered as the physical address. Then the page offset will be appended to that to get a particular portion of the main memory, which is a page of feature size. So very simple in the case of a paging. Now to reduce the size of the data structure, some complex some computers apply a hashing function to the virtual address to reduce the complexity of the data structure. So we are applying some hashing function along with the virtual address to evaluate the physical address of the data. The hash allows the data structure to be the length of the number of physical pages in the main memory. So in order to reduce address translation time, computers use cache dedicated, a special cache dedicated to the address translation, which is called as translation look aside buffer, TLB. A special cache is associated with this page table or segmentation table, which can be making the address translation easier. So the time taken for finding the particular address, that is conversion translation from virtual address to the physical address, along with the addition of the offset or that detail, if you use a translation look aside buffer, it will increase the speed of the entire memory communication. So this is the example where we are using a normal paging, that is the first one. So virtual address, processor will generate virtual address. So there will be virtual page number and offset. So virtual page number will be having a reference that will be added to the page table. So there will be a control bit for each page entry. Then there will be a page frame, corresponding frame number will be available here, and in that frame along with appending this offset will produce the actual physical memory where the actual data resides. So this is the page table. So we are having a reference address corresponding to the page table also here. So each entry, each virtual page number will be associated with the page table with a control bit and a frame number, and this frame number appended with the offset produce the physical memory, and that is connected to the main memory. But if you are using TLB, so here in the case we are using page table. Now we are using a translation look ahead buffer as a special cache. This virtual page number will not be always doing address translation. So after the first reference, so there will be a virtual page number as in the previous case. For each will be having control bits and will be having the corresponding frame. So this will be entered into the TLB, that is a separate cache. So next time a virtual address is being generated, it will just look whether it is a miss or hit, whether it is there in the TLB. It will look at the translation look ahead buffer. If it is there, it is considered as a hit. No, it is not required to have a calculation of means address translation and conversion into a physical address. If it is not there in TLB, it need to go for finding the address translation, and by adding the offset along with the physical address to form the virtual address plus offset to form the physical address. So TLB is a special cache associated with the page table that is used for the reference of any previously used pages. So if it is already being used, it will be there in the TLB. If there is a page entry, it will directly take a hit. If it is not available, there is a miss, so it will do the address translation and find out the corresponding physical address, and it will be entered into the TLB. Now if it is later being referred, that time it will be a hit here. It doesn't go for further address translation. So we can make the procedure faster when we are using a TLB. So a virtual address is given, the main memory unit looks in the TLB for the reference page. Just a look into the TLB. If the page is there in the TLB, the physical address is obtained immediately. If it is a miss, the entry will be obtained by page table in the main memory and the TLB is updated. So address translation is required at this page table. Now the next question is which block will be replaced on a miss. Which block will be replaced? So almost all operating system try to replace the least recently used block. The older one will be replaced. So that is the traditional thing. We are having many more replacement strategies available. So in order to remove that, the OS use least recently used, it provides a use bit or reference bit associated with each block. So by looking at this bit, you can decide that whether it is least recently used or most recently used. Accordingly, the page can be replaced. So the OS periodically clears the use bits and later records them so that it can determine which pages are touched during the particular time period, so that it can have a reference to the usage of each block at every time. Now what happens on a write? When we go for write into the memory, what will be happening? So the level below main memory rotating magnetic disk that take millions of clock cycles to access. So this is the secondary memory, this is the primary memory, then this is the cache and this is the processor. So this is secondary, this is primary, this is cache and this is processor. So The secondary always consists of disk that will be always rotating to find out a particular data. So it takes millions of clock cycles. The speed is means the time taken is more in the case of the secondary memory. Because of this, no one has yet built a virtual memory operating system that writes through main memory. So when we write something into the memory, it is not always trying to write through. Write through means after the operations, it will be written into the cache or it will be written into the primary memory. But it won't be returning it back permanently into the secondary storage because it will take more time. So writes through main memory to disk on every store by the processor. So write through is not being provided by many of the operating systems. So the write strategy used is write back. It will just write back into the primary memory. So we are considering from the primary memory point. We are not considering cache. So whichever memory is being utilized by the primary memory, the data will be written back into the primary memory itself. It won't be returning it back into the secondary storage as the clock cycles, number of clock cycles required for writing that back into the secondary storage is very high. Now, how we can add protection using virtual memory? So the page based virtual memory including a TLB. So TLB is a mechanism that is used for providing protection. It is the primary mechanism that protects processes from each other. So how different processes can be protected, P1 and P2, which are using the same memory, how we can do protection. So multiprogramming led to demand for protection and sharing among programs and to the concept of process. So a process has a running space plus any state needed to continue running it. So there will be context switching between these two processes. At a time only one process will be working, then it will be switching to the process 2, then it will be working. So as it is context switching, there won't be any effect on any of these two. So they won't be mixing each other. So it won't be sharing the common memory also at the same time. So context switching is a mechanism that is used for providing a protection to the memory with the support of virtual memory. So the OS and architecture allow processors to share the hardware yet not to interfere with each other. So the architecture must do the following. First point is it should provide two modes. One is a user mode and second one is an OS mode. So an operating system primary memory, there will be two portions. One is for operating system and second one is for the user. So you should have two provisions. So user can have access to only this area. OS should have access to this area as well as this area. So he can have some control. So there will be difference between user process and OS process. Provide a portion of the processor state that a user process can use but not write. So it can use and it cannot write. So some state can be utilized by the user that can simply use but he cannot write, and the users are prevented from writing processor state because the OS cannot control user processes if it gives this privilege to the user. So OS cannot provide all the privileges to the user. Provide mechanisms where the processor can go from user mode to supervisor mode. So there will be some situation when we need to move from the user mode to the supervisor mode. Some situation only the operating system need to do some operations. So that situation the mode must be automatically changed from user to the supervisor mode and reverse. Provide mechanism to limit memory accesses to protect the memory state of a process without having to swap the process on disk on a context switch. Limit, in order to provide a mechanism that is used to limit memory access to protect memory state, it is always better to provide, means reduce the context switch between disk and primary memory. Now paged virtual memory means that every memory access logically takes at least twice as long, with one memory access to obtain the physical address and second one is to get the data. So this is the total latency. One is for getting physical address and second one is access to getting the data. So This is actually a costly task because we are doing two operations. First, obtain the physical address, then access the data. So, one solution is to rely on the principle of locality. That is by keeping an address translation, a translation look aside buffer. So, from where we can access the data easier. So, this is another mechanism that is used for speeding up the operation as well as for providing protection by a virtual memory concept. So we have already seen about TLB. So find out physical address and access the data separately can be avoided by reference to the TLB. If already the data is being referred, the data will be available within that special cache memory called as TLB. Now, protection via virtual machines. So, what is virtual machine? Virtual machine, as the name indicates, these are like virtual memory. We are having virtual machines like virtual set of operating systems available, different controllers available. So, virtual machines were first developed in 1960. It became popular because of the following reasons. The increased importance of isolation and security in modern system. So every program, every operation that we are doing, that is to be isolated separately, and we should provide some security. So that situation, we need to have some monitoring virtual operating systems or machines available separately. The failures in security and reliability of standard operating system. So all the operating system does not support security and reliability. So that situation, we need to have this virtual type of machines. The sharing of a single computer among many unrelated users. So the system is being shared by many different users. So that situation, if we need to handle the operations properly, we need to have the support of a virtual machine. Also, the increase in the speed of processes, which make the overhead of virtual machine more acceptable. So when the number of processes and speed also increases, it is always better to have a support from another virtual machine. Most often the virtual machine supports the same instruction set architecture as in the underlying hardware. It is also possible to support a different instruction set architecture also, and is often employed when migrating between different ISAs. In certain virtual machines, ISA presented by the virtual machine and the underlying hardware match. So the hardware and the ISA present that is in the virtual machine are actually matching for several virtual machines, and these machines are usually called as system virtual machines. So most of the systems, it will be different, the instruction set architecture and the underlying hardware will be different, but whichever case, if they are matching, we can call it as system virtual machines. A single computer runs multiple virtual machines and can support a number of different operating systems. A single computer runs multiple virtual machines and can support different types of operating systems. On a conventional platform, a single OS owns all the hardware resources, but with virtual machine, multiple OSs share the hardware resources. The difference between traditional OS, single OS system, here multiple OS virtual machines are controlling the different hardware resources. Now, virtual machine monitor, that is a software that supports virtual machines, are called as virtual machine monitor, or which is also called as hypervisor. Software that supports virtual machines. So previously we were discussing about virtual machines which imitates different operating systems. Now the software that is used to provide this mechanism is called as virtual machine monitor, and the underlying hardware platform is called as host machine, and the resources of the host are shared among different guest virtual machines. The resources of that single hardware is being shared among different virtual machines,
And virtual machine monitor determines how to map virtual resources to physical resources. So the mapping between virtual resources that is not available to the real physical resources is also determined by the virtual machine monitor. And the cost of processor virtualization depends on the total workload of the system. Now, two commercially used or commercially significant benefits of virtual machines are: it manages different software. It provides, that is, provides an abstraction that can run with complete software stack, even including old OS and old OS like disk operating system also. It can manage all types of software that was used with earlier operating system as well as newer operating systems, and it can also manage different hardwares. That depends on any type of hardware. It can run independently of the type of hardware that is being used with the current system. The requirements of a virtual machine monitor. What are the different requirements? So the quantitative requirements are a guest software should have a virtual memory exactly as if they were running in the native hardware. So the guest software should have virtual machine exactly as it is there in the native hardware. Similarly, a guest software should not be able to change allocation of real system resources directly. So it should not allow the allocation of real system resources directly. So to virtualize the processor, the virtual machine monitor must control the access to privilege state, address translation, I/O exception and interrupts, even though the guest virtual machine and OS currently running are temporarily using them. So in order to do virtualization, it should do all these operations like give privileges, do address translation, do IOI operation, exceptions and other interrupts, or all the operations that an operating system can do. For example, in the case of a timer interrupt, the virtual machine monitor would suspend the currently running guest virtual machine, save it current state, handle the interrupt and determine which guest virtual machine to run next. It is actually done by a normal operating system. The same thing should also be done with a virtual processor also. So virtual memory, we were discussing about virtual memory, the usage of virtual memory to provide address references and the different mechanism for doing virtual memory, that is applying virtual memory by using paging and segmentation, the difference between paging and segmentation, and how we can do address translation from virtual address to physical address in the case of paging and segmentation. And we have also seen the usages of virtual memory. Then we have seen virtual machines, the uses of virtual machines, the situations when we are using virtual machines, and finally we have seen the virtual machine monitor, which provides the support for creating virtual machine which is acting as a complete system, who controls the entire system like a particular operating system. So that is all about the virtual memory. Thank you.